like to make a call. Please hang up and try again.
Kayle Alan Fleischauer was charged with the shooting death of his 19-year-old son, Chase, at the family home in Wisconsin in April 2018. Kayle was found guilty in his June 2019 trial. However, the judge ordered a new trial after discovering juror misconduct. Presented here is the retrial, which ran from the 24th of February to the 3rd of March 2020. Unlike the first trial, Kayle did not testify in his own defense at retrial.
Thank you. Can you state your name and spell your last for the record, please?
Summer Lynn Johnson-Fleischauer, J-O-H-N-S-O-N-F-L-E-I-S-C-H-A-U-E-R.
And how old are you?
I'm 23.
And where do you currently live?
I'm in St. Paul, Minnesota.
Do you work right now?
Yes.
And where do you work?
For Cornerstone Advocacy Services.
Did you recently graduate from college?
Yes.
And when and where did you graduate from college?
From the University of Minnesota, Twin Cities, in May of 2019.
And what was your degree in?
I majored in youth studies and minored in family violence prevention.
Summer, who was a part of your immediate family growing up?
My mom, my brother Chase, and our two half-siblings.
And what's your mom's name?
April Johnson.
And what are your siblings' names?
Chase Fleischauer, Samantha Johnson, and Camden Johnson-Simon.
Okay. Who is your father?
Kayle Fleischauer.
And is he present here today in the courtroom?
Yes.
And when you got there, who was there?
Just our dad.
Do you find that unusual?
Yes.
Why?
Because usually when we see our dad, there's someone else there. And so Chase had asked, like, where's Annette? Where's Grandma? Kind of, where's somebody else?
And how did the defendant respond, if you know?
That Annette was out with her girlfriends. And then he said, why does Grandma have to be here?
So when you got there, anybody else in the home besides the defendant?
No.
Now, when you went to sleep, did you hear anything happen after 1 a.m.?
Yes.
And what did you hear happen?
I could hear motion coming from upstairs, like motion, and then I heard one of them yell, fuck you, and the other one yelled, fuck you, and I could hear Chase say, I would never hit my father.
How do you know who it was that was saying, fuck you, fuck you?
I couldn't tell which one of them had said it and then said it back, but I could tell from Chase's voice that I would never hit my father because it was long enough for me to hear and tell distinguish that was Chase's voice.
Okay. How clear were you able to hear Chase say, I would never hit my father?
Clearly? That, Your Honor, is lack of foundation. Well,
sustained as to the form.
Was it that argument or that noise? Is that what initially woke you up?
Move would be stricken the part about argument.
Sustained as to argumentative characterization.
The words that you heard being said by the defendant and your brother, is that what initially woke you up?
Yes.
After you heard Chase say, I would never hit my father, what, if anything, did you do?
I yelled upstairs and said, Chase, it's time for bed. Chase, come to bed.
Why did you say that?
Object to this, Your Honor. It's the conclusion of the witness.
Overruled. You can answer. Well, I believe you did answer a question, Ms. Ellenwood.
I'm sorry, could you repeat the question?
Why did you tell Chase to come to bed?
Because it was late and I could hear him upstairs, so I yelled for him to come down to bed.
Okay. To the best of your knowledge, did Chase come downstairs then after you told him to come to bed with you?
No.
What's the next thing that you remember?
That I'd heard something extremely loud from upstairs. Like a very loud noise come from upstairs, like just so loud that I knew something was wrong. Like it sounded like it could have been like a hardwood, like a wooden chair hitting like a hardwood floor, like sharp and loud.
After you heard that noise, what did you do?
I immediately went upstairs.
What were you screaming at your dad to do?
I screamed to call 911. I said, yeah, I was screaming at him to call 911.
And what's happening as you're telling him to call 911?
He's saying, it's okay, he's okay. And then he's saying, Summer, listen, listen. And then he kept saying, it's okay. And then I started screaming at him to call 911. And then he started reaching for his phone that was on the island.
Now, in this exhibit here, if you know, are you able to see roughly where the defendant's phone was?
I don't know where it would have been exactly, but he had grabbed it off of the island.
On what part of the island, left or right of the island?
It would have been on the left part of the island and probably in the front, because it has like the level of, here's the top part of the island, the second part of the island would have been on that lower section of the island.
When the defendant grabbed his cell phone, what happened?
I was telling him to call 911 and he said no. And then I was saying, give me your phone. I was screaming at him to give me the phone then, and he was saying no. I said, give me your fucking phone, and he wouldn't, and then he held it up over his head when I was trying to grab it from him. And then I ran downstairs to go get my phone.
If you know, how long did the defendant hold the phone over his head?
It felt like a long time where I was trying to grab it from him, and I obviously wasn't going to be able to get it from him. That's why I ran.
Not responsive, Your Honor.
Can you estimate how long it was? And if you can't, you can't.
I don't recall exactly how long it was.
Thank you. Ms. Ellenwood?
Were you ever able to get the defendant's phone?
No.
What did you do next?
I ran downstairs to get my phone, and then I called 911, and then I ran back upstairs to be with Chase.
When you talked with 911, did they ask you for the address of the home?
Yes.
And were you able to give it to them?
No, I didn't remember what the address of the house was.
So what did you do?
I asked my dad for the address.
Did he give it to you?
He said no.
What happened after he said no, he wouldn't give you the address?
There's a bunch of mail on the island where like they take their mail in and leave it there. So I grabbed a piece of mail and I read the address off to the dispatcher off the piece of mail.
Good afternoon. Would you state your name, spell your first and last name for us, and please speak up so everyone can hear you.
Katrina Beckstrom, Katrina Beckstrom.
Could you tell us about your different jobs that you have, please?
Sure. My primary job is I lead our data analytics team for Health Partners, and I have a second job as an emergency medical technician with the New Richmond Area Ambulance Service.
What is Health Partners?
Health Partners is an integrated healthcare company in the Twin Cities.
What's your job in New Richmond?
I'm an advanced emergency medical technician.
How long have you been an emergency medical technician?
Going on 7.5 years, I believe.
What education and training do you have to be an emergency medical technician?
I've gone through two courses at WITC, the technical college, related to emergency medical services.
Are you licensed and certified as an emergency medical technician?
Yes,
I am. And are you required to maintain continuing education in that field to keep those certifications and license?
Yes, I am.
What makes you an advanced emergency medical technician?
I've gone through a second course that is more focused on patient assessment and being able to provide more advanced care and start IVs.
Were you doing the job of being an advanced emergency medical technician on April 14th, 2018?
Yes, I was.
At about 4 o'clock or shortly after that in the morning, where were you?
I was at the ambulance station in New Richmond.
Is that in the city of New Richmond?
Yes, it is.
All right. Were you waiting for the possibility of a call?
Yes, I was on call that morning.
At about 4:13 in the morning, what, if any, dispatch did you receive?
We received a page for a gunshot wound to the head.
After paramedic Edwards stopped the ambulance in the driveway where you described, what did you do?
I got out and started getting our equipment out of the side compartment of the ambulance.
And what was paramedic Edwards doing?
She went into the back of the ambulance to grab additional equipment.
What did you grab?
I grabbed our Lucas device.
Which is what?
It's a device that's used to do chest compressions during CPR.
Where did you go then?
You yourself.
Use an interesting word. Unless I say otherwise, I will only be talking about you personally, okay?
Okay.
All right, so where did you go then?
I went to the front door.
Who, if anyone, was at the front door?
Summer was at the front door.
Was the door open?
Yes.
What was she doing?
She was yelling frantically for us to help her brother.
Now, you've used her name Summer today because since then you've learned who she is. Did you know her before this?
No, I did not.
Did you know any of the people in this case?
No,
this?
I did not.
Is there any further physical description you can think of that you can give us of the person who was laying on top of the patient?
Yes. So it was a larger man that did not have a shirt on, bald head, and wearing pajama pants.
At the point at which that person was laying on the patient, what, if any, assessment were you able to make of the patient's condition?
I was not able to assess the patient.
What did you do?
I walked around the patient to his right side and knelt down. And tapped the man on top of him and told him I needed him to move so I could see the patient's head.
Where did you tap the person who was laying on top of the patient?
On his shoulder back area.
Were you at his head when you did that or at his side?
At his head, side kind of.
How did that person react to your physical request?
He did not initially respond, so I tapped again and told him I needed him to move and pushed him to move him, and he did then slowly get up and turn and look at me.
When he looked at you, what did you see?
No expression, no reaction.
Did you see any tears?
No, I did not.
Now, when you went up to talk to him, did you have gloves on at that point?
Yes, I did.
When did you put the gloves on?
I put those gloves on as we pull into the driveway and get ready to get out of the truck.
So once this person got up off of your patient, how quickly did they do that?
It was quite slow.
Where did that person go?
I'm not sure where he went from then. I was focused on the patient at that point.
Once he was moved, what's the first thing you noticed about the patient?
I noticed a significant, obvious wound to his head.
Can you describe it for us?
Yes. It was positioned forehead, crown area, just slight right. There was significant bone and brain matter around the wound.
What was your first reaction to that serious of a wound?
That was a very significant injury.
While you were making that observation, what, if any, life signs did you see from the patient?
I looked at the patient's arms, legs, his torso area to see any movement, which I did not. I did a sternal rub, which is taking your knuckles and rubbing the sternum to try to elicit a response because of the pain. Which there was no response. And I checked for a pulse on the carotid artery on the left side of his neck, as I did not want to move the head, and I did not feel a pulse.
Based on those observations, how, if in any way, did that confirm your initial observation that this was a very serious wound?
At that point, the patient was determined to be unresponsive and potentially deceased.
Deputy, would you state your name and spell your last name for us? And please speak up so everyone can hear you.
It's Chase DuRand, C-H-A-S-E. Last name is D-U. R is capitalized, A-N-D.
Where do you work?
The Sheriff's Office, St. Craig County.
What's your job there?
I'm a patrol deputy.
How long have you been a police officer?
Been a police officer since 2013.
How long have you been with the St. Croix County Sheriff's Office?
Since May of 2015.
What are your duties as a patrol deputy?
We're assigned a patrol area to watch for traffic violations, suspicious activity, respond to emergencies, and other calls for service.
Can you summarize for us what training you've had in relation to your responsibility as a patrol deputy to be the first responder to a crime scene?
In the police academy, we are trained on scene response and securing the scene, evaluating the scene for evidence, officer safety.
Were you doing that job in the early morning hours of April 14th, 2018?
I was.
What shift were you working that day?
I was working an overnight shift from 9 p.m. to 6:30 a.m.
Sorry, I was talking and I apologize. From when to when?
The assigned shift is from 9 p.m. to 6:30 a.m.
Were you working in uniform?
I was.
Did you have a marked squad vehicle?
I did.
What kind of car, what kind of vehicle was that?
My assigned patrol vehicle is a Ford pickup truck.
What other responsibilities do you have with the St. Croix County Sheriff's Office that might end up with your squad vehicle being a pickup truck?
I'm assigned the rec officer. I handle the water patrol, ATV, and snowmobile patrol for the Sheriff's Office.
Rec being short for recreation?
Recreation patrol.
So what kind of recreational activities that people engage in are you responsible for monitoring?
I patrol the waters on our patrol boat and also snowmobile patrol for the trails.
And besides patrolling and aside from the recreational activities, what other unit in your department are you assigned to?
I'm assigned to our emergency response unit or SWAT team.
And the SWAT team is specifically trained in emergency responses, is that correct?
Yes.
On the morning of April 14th, 2018, about 4:12 in the morning, what, if any, call were you dispatched to?
I was dispatched to a 20-year-old male with a gunshot wound to his head.
Where else did you take photographs?
I took as many photographs as I could as of the upstairs. I took photographs near the sliding glass door onto the deck and out of the deck, and there was a handgun that was on the island that was moved there by Officer Sather. I took photographs of.
And did there also come a time when you took photographs of the defendant?
Yes.
All right. So let's see if we can put those in order. All right. So you said you took photos of the victim first. Correct?
Yes, I photographs of the victim in the surrounding area were first.
And then what do you think you took pictures of next after that?
There were some photographs of the handgun. And then I went back to taking photographs of the area.
While you were taking the pictures you described, how, if in any way, did you notice the defendant begin to behave?
While I was taking photographs, I heard the defendant start to laugh out loud and rub his stomach in a circular motion, making comments about how fat he was.
What did you do at that point?
At that point, I stopped taking photographs. Sergeant Coleman and I thought that was strange, and we went down to the landing where the defendant was standing, and I activated my Olympus pocket recorder I had in my shirt pocket.
When you went to where the defendant was, what were you intending to try to do?
Sergeant Coleman started asking some questions, and I still had my camera on me, and I noticed there was some blood on the defendant. I started taking photographs.
Had you been taking photographs of blood elsewhere in the house?
Yes.
And what happened when you started taking photographs of the blood on the defendant?
He started to become upset and loud.
Well, how could you tell he was upset?
He was getting loud and exaggerated. He asked if I wanted to start something, I believe is what he said. He called me Sunshine, and then he asked if I wanted some of his, he said, cock. And he pulled down the front of his pants, exposing his penis multiple times. I told him to stop, and he continued to pull down his pants.
Good afternoon. Would you state your name, spell your first and last name for us, and please speak up so everyone can hear you?
Tracy Drager, TracyDrager.
Where do you work?
Wisconsin State Patrol.
What's your job there?
I am a trooper assigned to the Technical Reconstruction Unit.
How long have you been a Wisconsin State Trooper?
8 years.
What's the Technical Reconstruction Unit?
We specialize in crash reconstruction and crime scene diagramming.
How long have you done that for?
Since 2015.
What was your job before that?
I was a trooper assigned to a corridor on the interstate.
Showing what's been marked as Exhibit 117 for identification, could you tell us what that document is, please?
This is my curriculum vitae.
Is it a true and accurate depiction of your training and qualifications?
It is.
Move Exhibit 117 into evidence.
No, no objection.
Receive.
Could you tell us what specific training instruction you've received for purposes of being a technical reconstructionist?
In August of 2015, I took a two-week crash reconstruction course, and I've taken a number of courses since then in specialized training within that area.
Is technical reconstruction limited only to traffic behavior?
No.
What is used to do technical reconstruction?
Generally, we respond and map crime or crash scenes using total stations or 3D scanners and render scenes in a 2D or a 3D CAD computer-aided drawing environment on the computer afterwards.
So in your work, CAD stands for computer-aided drawing?
Correct.
Did there come a time when you were asked to assist with a computer-aided drawing of the area of the upper level of 1489 142nd Street in Richmond Township, Wisconsin?
Yes.
What were you given in order to be able to do that?
I was given a series of measurements recorded at, my understanding was they were recorded at the scene, handwritten, hand-drawn, not-to-scale diagram of the scene, and a series of photographs of the scene.
Who'd you get those from?
The crime lab.
Showing you what's been marked as Exhibit 118 for identification, do you recognize that document?
I do.
What is it?
This is my scaled scene diagram that I completed based on the measurements provided by the crime lab.
And is Exhibit 118 prepared by you, consistent with your training and experience and the protocols you've been taught for using the computer-aided drawing program?
Yes.
Move Exhibit 118 into evidence.
Objection.
Received.
Ask to publish.
Yes.
The numbers that appear, how are they identified on your Exhibit 118?
The numbers that appear were, they correlate to the numbers given to me by the crime lab, and they are listed below in the box in the lower right corner to identify what they are pointing at.
What does the computer-aided drawing program allow you to provide to someone in a drawing? In terms of measurements?
It is a scaled depiction of the crime scene as it was documented at the scene. So if I take, if I'm given measurements of the dimensions of a room, I can create that room to scale to fit a piece of paper so it can be shown in scale.
Where is the scale on Exhibit 118?
The scale is in the box on the lower left-hand corner. underneath, it would be drawn by Drager. There's a scale underneath that.
So the the little bar goes from 0 feet to 10 feet?
Correct, yes.
And your scale drawing is scaled to that measurement?
Correct.
The item that you have marked as number 8, you have it marked with an asterisk, is that correct?
That's correct.
First of all, let's start with what the marking was. What, in other words, what was it that you then decided to put number 8 where you put it?
So the marking was on the hand-drawn diagram of the scene. It was a piece of paper. It was indicated to me later that that was the approximate location of where the weapon was located.
So the asterisk is because it's approximate, is that correct?
That is correct.
But utilizing, as you indicated earlier, if I'm wrong, correct me, mm-hmm. utilizing the photographs, the drawing that you received, and the other measurements in your program, you were able to place number 8 where the piece of paper with the drawing of the pistol on it was in the hallway, is that right?
Correct.
Okay. What then was the measurement based on your CAD program that you used from number 8 to some place on Chase's body, and I'll ask you where.
So the measurement was 10 feet, 10.9 inches.
From where to where?
From the foot to approximately the middle of the weapon.
From Chase's foot. In fact, you have like a little line and an arrow by his foot. Is that correct?
Correct. It would be the left foot.
Just a little bit to the left of number 12 where you've written white, red stains. Is that right?
Correct.
Thank you. Can you state your name for the record and spell your last, please?
Benjamin DeStaercke, D-E, capital S-T-A-E-R-C-K-E.
Where are you employed?
Right now I am a crime scene response specialist at the Milwaukee Crime Laboratory.
What are some of your duties that you do as a at the crime scene response unit?
We had just started a full-time crime scene response unit. My primary duty in that is to participate in our crime scene unit, and also I am basically in charge of external training to law enforcement agencies throughout the state.
Before you did that and joined that unit, what did you do previously?
I was a senior DNA analyst at the Madison Crime Laboratory.
How long have you been doing that for?
I was a DNA analyst for approximately 12 and a half years.
Would you say an area of specialty that you have is DNA analysis?
Yes.
Okay. Can you tell us how many forensic DNA cases you've worked on?
Approximately 650.
Have you previously testified as an expert witness in courts of law here in Wisconsin?
Yes, I have.
Do you know approximately how many times?
I believe 24.
Mr. DeStaercke, I just want to talk in general. Can you explain to us what is DNA?
DNA basically is the genetic blueprint of who we are. It codes or makes up what we are, say, to make us a human, to have two eyes, two legs, two arms, to just give us a structural background for the cells we have. It'll basically be a blueprint to say, cells, we need you to do this right now. We need you to produce this. DNA is inherited half from your biological mother and half from your biological father. Those will combine and make up what you are.
Is an individual's DNA the same throughout their body?
Yes, it is. That is one of the hallmarks that lets us do our testing in DNA. The DNA that you will find on what we call buccal swabs, which is just a swab from the inside of your cheek. We use that for standards from people to identify that this DNA is this person. That DNA will be the exact same as DNA from your blood, as DNA from semen, saliva in this case, or just your skin cells. They'll all be the same DNA.
Did you just describe the different types of DNA that can be collected or sampled?
Generally, yes.
Okay. What are those types of DNA that could be collected or sampled?
The ones that we work with mostly would be a lot of biological fluids, or touch DNA is another one. Biological fluids, blood, semen, saliva, Those are great sources of DNA. The other one, touch DNA, would be if, say for instance, I would touch this table. There's a possibility that I could leave my DNA on that table, and then someone would come along later, swab that area or sample from that area, depending on what the surface is, and collect some of that DNA. The only, not a problem with touch DNA, but touch DNA, you don't know how much you're leaving. Per person, it could fluctuate. It could be a variable. Like in the morning, I could leave more DNA than the afternoon. It's all dependent on if you're sweating, if you're someone who just sheds a lot of cells, a lot of skin. They will tend to leave more DNA. So, and it depends on the conditions that the DNA is being left in. If it's a controlled environment like this would be kind of optimal, but if it's going to be outside in the weather conditions, there's many different factors that would factor into how much DNA would be left for touch DNA.
I want to draw your attention to April 14th of 2018. On that day, were you a part of the crime scene response unit?
Yes, I was.
And were you directed to come up to 1489 142nd Street in the town of Richmond, Wisconsin?
Yes.
And who was a part of your team that day, if you recall?
Nick Stalky was the team leader, and Samantha Delfoss was the photographer.
And what role did you play that day, Mr. DeStaercke?
I was the what we call the number three individual, which is kind of the extra person on the team. I, in this instance, took the crime scene video at the scene, and the number three person is at the discretion of the team leader for whatever they need done at the scene.
What did you do that day, if you remember?
As I said, I took the video from that day, sampled from some of the items we took that we collected, and did some presumptive field testing of the blood at the scene.
What is presumptive field testing?
We have a test within the laboratory. It's basically a color change test that if blood is present on an object or on the swab that we are testing, we can, if it turns a pink color, we can say that blood is possibly present. And we can only say possibly present due to there are other items that could give a false reading to this positive test. Horseradish would be one of those. Rust is possible. But if you do see this test, there's a possible presence of blood on that item.
So it could either be blood, horseradish, or rust?
Those are just a couple of the false positives that you can get. But with a blood stain, you will get the positive test also.
Again, Mr. DeStaercke, what are we seeing in this photo?
In this photograph is marker number 15, which was placed on a stool, and it was placed next to some reddish brown staining.
Do you know where in the kitchen this stool was?
I believe it was next to where the trash is.
Now, I see some tape in the photo. What is that, if you know?
It is scale tape that was placed there by us to make sure where we knew where that staining was on the stool to give the kind of coordinates of it, the measurements on that stool, where the staining was.
I see a small white piece of tape kind of in the middle under the 10 to 15. What is that?
That is another scale, a little smaller one, placed directly next to the stain that was collected to show how big that stain was in a photograph.
And is that area where you took the swab?
Yes, it was.
Okay. Mr. DeStaercke, do you recall seeing taking a swab here by Chase's foot?
Yes.
And what was the result of that DNA analysis that you concluded?
A single source male DNA profile was developed from that swabbing, and Chase Fleischauer was the source. And I should add, when I say source, we do have a policy in our laboratory that when we run statistics on the sample, that anything more than 1 in 7 trillion as a stat, which is approximately 1,000 times the world's population, we just call that person the source of that DNA.
Okay. Mr. DeStaercke, Investigator Miklo will approach you with Exhibit 22. Can you take a look at that? Mr. DeStaercke, have you seen that exhibit before?
Yes, I have.
And when or how did you see that?
It was submitted for evidence in this case.
Did you handle that firearm for a collection of evidence?
Yes, I did.
Okay. Appear to be the same firearm that you analyzed and collected for evidence?
Yes, the only addition is the, I believe, trigger lock that was added.
Thank you, Investigator. May I approach Judge with Exhibit 38 for demonstrative?
Yes.
No, Mr. DeStaercke, I'm giving you Exhibit 38. Can you explain for the jury where and how you tested that firearm for DNA?
I tested from four different areas of the firearm, four different swabbings. One of the swabbings was from the grips area on both sides, where someone would typically handle the firearm. Another area was from the slide. I should say the textured portions of the slide where there's kind of little ridges. Another area I tested was from, I swabbed the trigger. And the last area is around the barrel on the firearm.
Can you show me again where the grips of the firearm you tested?
I took a swabbing from each of the sides of the firearm, kind of down on the handle.
And what were the results of the DNA analysis that you did on the grips of that firearm?
I found a mixture of at least four individuals from that swabbing. And when I say there's four individuals, we have a DNA profile, and as I explained yesterday, a normal person would have two types at each marker location. And in this profile, I saw at least seven or eight types at locations. So just doing the math on that, if you see eight types at a location, you kind of divide that by two, and you can reasonably assume that, or estimate that there's at least four individuals present. Also from that, I was able to say that there were at least two male contributors present from that swabbing. But due to the amount of material and information that I had, I was not able to do any conclusions on that profile. So I was not able to compare it to anybody.
So you weren't able to say in layman's terms who those two male DNA profiles you had found would be?
No, I was not.
Thank you. Can you state your name for the record and spell your last?
Yes, my name is Jennifer Burnside, B-U-R-N-S-I-D-E.
Ms. Burnside, where are you employed?
I'm currently employed with the Colorado Bureau of Investigation as a forensic scientist in the toxicology unit.
And how long have you been employed there?
Since August of 2019.
Before August of 2019, where did you work?
I was employed at the Wisconsin State Crime Laboratory in Madison from 2016 to 2019 as a senior forensic toxicologist.
Can you briefly describe what your training and experience is to hold that position?
Yes, I have a Bachelor of Science degree in biology, concentrated in molecular biology from Eastern Oregon University. In addition, I successfully completed the training program outlined by the Wisconsin State Crime Lab and complete continuing education courses yearly, which help keep me up to date in the field of toxicology.
Ms. Burnside, as a toxicologist, what are some samples or things that you are testing during the course of your duties?
My role is to test biological specimens, so that is body fluids such as blood and urine, for the presence of drug and alcohol content.
When you did that, was that at the Wisconsin State Crime Lab?
Yes.
And do you know, does the lab have a permit to do that?
Yes.
Based on Exhibit 154, and briefly, if you can describe to the jury, what experience and training do you have in alcohol analysis specifically?
In addition to completing the alcohol training program at the Wisconsin State Crime Lab, I have also attended the Robert F. Borkenstein Alcohol Course on Highway Safety. This is a week-long, 8-hour-a-day course that is very intensive and goes through the pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics of alcohol.
In layman's terms, are you testing someone's blood to see how much alcohol is in it?
Yes.
How many times have you done that?
At the Wisconsin State Crime Lab, I have tested hundreds of samples. However, in my career, I have tested thousands.
Have you seen that document before, Ms. Burnside?
Yes.
And what is it?
This is the confidential report of laboratory findings. This is a report that I authored.
And does it appear to be a true and accurate depiction of the report that you authored on July 5th of 2018?
Yes.
And who was the subject of that report, if you know?
The individual listed is Kayle A. Fleischauer.
And with this report, does it indicate if you tested someone's blood?
Yes.
And whose blood did you test?
The blood tested was Kayle A. Fleischauer.
And again, is this a true and accurate depiction of your report that you made on July 5th of 2018?
Yes.
We'd move for the admission of 173.
No objection.
Received.
Can you briefly tell the jury how you test blood for the presence of alcohol?
Yes. Alcohol analysis is broken up into three sections: the preparation, the instrument analysis, and then the data interpretation. So briefly, I would remove a blood sample from a refrigerator, allow it to come to room temperature so it's a homogeneous or an equal concentration, take two portions of that blood, place them in two separate labeled vials. These vials are then sealed and placed on an instrument. The instrument is called a headspace gas chromatograph flame ionization detector, which is a long name for a piece of equipment that detects volatiles, such as ethanol or drinking alcohol, in biological specimen.
From that tubes, were you able to run them through that machine that you had previously described?
I tested one of the blood tubes. This is common practice. The second tube is usually saved for additional testing by an outside agency if you request.
So you took one blood sample and tested it?
Yes.
And can you briefly just tell the jury how you tested that blood?
I removed the two portions of blood and placed them into the sealed, labeled vials, placed them on the instrument. The instrument is able to separate the different volatile components in a sample and then detect how much is there in each.
How much of what?
Different volatiles. So this is a class of alcohols. It would be ethanol that most people know as drinking alcohol. But it also detects acetone, isopropanol, and methanol.
With regards to the reading of that report, did you get an ethanol analysis of how much alcohol or ethanol was in that blood sample?
Yes.
And what was that result?
The result was 0.195 grams per 100 milliliters of ethanol.
Now, are you aware of when that blood sample may or may not have been taken from the individual named Kayle Fleischauer?
Listed on the report, the blood sample was taken at 1350 hours on April 14th or 1:50 in the afternoon.
April 14th of 2018?
Yes.
Is there a process, Ms. Burnside, in which you're able to determine what an alcohol concentration may have been in an individual's body perhaps 10 hours before that?
Partially. There is a calculation.
I'll object, Your Honor. The rest of this isn't responsive.
And I think that's either yes or no.
Yes, but I need to restate how it was said.
Well, Ms. Ellenwood will restate what she wants then. So yes, you can, Ms. Ellenwood.
Is there a way to determine or make an estimation of what someone's blood alcohol content could have been at a previous time during the day?
Yes.
Okay. What is that process called?
The calculation is called retrograde extrapolation. And what it is when we are given a known blood alcohol concentration. In this case, it would be 0.195. Then certain assumptions can be made, and if those assumptions are accepted, it can be calculated back to give an approximate blood alcohol concentration at a previous point in time.
Good afternoon. Would you state your name, spell your first and last name for us, and please speak up so everyone can hear you.
Kelly Marie Mills. What was the rest of the question? I'm sorry,
my fault. I don't have the microphone. So you've stated your name. Can you spell your first and last name for us? And please speak up so everyone can hear you.
Kellymills.
Where do you work?
At the Ramsey County Medical Examiner's Office in St. Paul, Minnesota.
What's your job there?
I'm the chief medical examiner there.
How long have you worked there?
Over 17 and a half years.
What is your job as a medical examiner?
In the people that we serve in Ramsey County, we help determine whether individuals need to come to our office for either an autopsy or an external exam, but our ultimate job is to certify deaths with cause and manner of death, and then, if so needed, to testify in trials.
And what medical procedure is performed on the subjects of your examination in order to help you determine cause and manner of death?
An autopsy.
Now, you said that you work out of St. Paul, Ramsey County. How, if in any way, does it come to be that you would be here joining us in Hudson, in St. Croix County, on a homicide case?
We also work as a referral agency to smaller counties that don't have their own facilities to perform forensic autopsies. The next one is the same exact setup, except this one is 6 inches away. So the photograph on the left is showing, again, you can see soot on the board. You can also see it on the photograph on the right. And if you look at the actual defect in the board, you see that grayish discoloration in the edges of the paper going into what the wound would be, which, again, we did not see in the edges of the skin of Chase, either with the naked eye or microscopically. And the photograph on the right is now kind of giving you a better close-up so you can appreciate the unburned gunpowder flakes getting embedded into the surface of the paper target board, and I measured that at 4 5/8 by 5 1/4.
The next measurement?
This is at 9 inches away now, so the barrel's 9 inches away from the surface of this paper cardboard. And the photograph on the left is showing a very faint, it's probably not even appreciable to you. And the photograph on the right is again showing you a closer up, showing the unburned gunpowder flakes embedded into the surface of the paper. I measured that at 5 5/8 by 5 3/4.
And tell us again, what is it about noting the soot here that's important in relation to what you did or didn't find in Chase?
Soot is one of the two factors that we use to determine range of fire. Soot is not appreciated at farther ranges. Gunpowder stippling is appreciated for a longer range. So soot puts the end of the barrel closer to a target. Gunpowder stippling still keeps it close range, and it does eventually, the gunpowder won't make it to the surface of the skin. That makes it a distant gunshot wound. We don't have soot or gunpowder stippling. It's called a distant gunshot wound.
What, if any, soot did you find in Chase?
I did not find any.
Was that when you stopped measuring at 9 inches?
Yes, that is correct.
Thank you. Mr. Burton, where do you reside?
974 80th Avenue, Roberts, Wisconsin.
And where did you grow up?
I grew up in Hudson, Wisconsin.
And how old of a man are you?
I'm 44 years old.
And are you married?
I am.
And children?
Two children.
Ages?
21 and 19.
And where are you employed?
Bremer Bank in Lake Elmo, Minnesota.
And do you have any other employment?
I am co-owner of the newly founded Confidence Gun Safety and Self-Defense as of January 2020.
Is that gotten off the ground yet as a business?
Just got the LLC set up.
And if you could let me rule on objections before there's answers. Overruled, he's given the answer. Mr. Gray.
Do you know Kayle Fleischauer?
I do.
And how long have you known him?
In a professional sense, I met Mr. Fleischauer at a large Fortune 500 company, 3M Corporation in St. Paul, Minnesota, in 2004, I believe.
And where are you employed now, at Bremer Bank?
Correct.
And what's your employment there? What do you do?
I am a technologist. I work IT for several Wisconsin branches.
And back in 2004, where did you work?
3M Corporation.
That's where you met Kayle Fleischauer?
Correct.
What did he do there?
We both served in a server administration capacity, working with Wintel servers in the technology department. I have a son that's the same age as Chase. We spoke regularly about the children.
Static uniform firearm testing apparatus was made of metal and glass, is that correct?
Correct.
Or plastic, was it like a plastic or?
It was a Lexan bullet resistant plastic.
Okay. None of it moved after the shot was fired in any of your scenarios, is that correct?
That's correct.
Do you have any basis upon which to believe that if it was as you posited to be, that Chase shot himself, is there any basis upon which you believe that Chase didn't move after he was shot?
I don't know if I have an opinion.
I'm not asking your opinion. I'm asking whether you have...
Object, Your Honor. He interrupted the witness.
Well, no. He said I don't have an opinion. So what's the next question, Mr. Kaiser?
I'm not asking if you have an opinion. I'm asking if you have a basis upon which to believe that by having this static uniform, cuneiform firearm
static
testing...
Static human form firearm testing.
Human form. Oh, I thought you said cuneiform.
Sorry.
No problem. Is there any basis in the facts of this case upon which you concluded that it was an accurate reproduction of this event to have your static human form firearm testing apparatus not move after the shot was fired?
The scope and the objective of my testing focused solely on the energy of the gun when it was fired and the distance that it traveled from that energy and the condition of the readiness of the pistol where it landed. Does that help?
It does help me ask my next question, which is that focus caused you to pay no attention to what, if any, effect the falling away of the human body from the shot being fired would have on where the gun did or didn't go.
That variable was not tested.
And you don't dispute with me, do you, that had Chase shot himself, as you posited it, he still yet would have fallen away from the shot being fired?
Again, with the variables in question here, I couldn't comment on that.
And nor could you account for it in your testing?
Correct.
Good morning. Would you state your name, spell your first and last name for us, and please speak up so everyone can hear you.
Good morning. Michael.
You're going to have to pull that really close.
Michael B. McGee, MCGEE, medical examiner, or the past medical examiner for Ramsey County.
I'm going to ask you to speak up a little bit more, doctor.
Yes, sir.
I appreciate that. Thank you. What do you mean by past medical examiner of Ramsey County?
And I retired January 1st. I still work in the office, but technically speaking, Dr. Mills has assumed the position while I continue to work in the office, finding my replacement.
So what is Dr. Mills' title now?
Medical examiner.
And that was your title, you're telling us?
True.
From when to when?
Basically from 1985 until January 1st of 2020.
So, doctor, how long have you been are you a physician licensed to practice medicine?
Yes.
What's your specialty?
Forensic pathology.
How long or since when have you been a medical doctor?
Since graduation from medical school in 1975.
How long have you been a forensic pathologist?
My entire career.
And just briefly, what is the job of a forensic pathologist?
The job of a forensic pathologist is to either you work for the county or you provide results to a county to help determine cause and manner of death, an investigation of people's death that occur in the jurisdiction, sometimes natural, sometimes not, and if not, trying to help investigators and the family understand what led to the person's death.
Are you board certified?
Yes.
In what?
Anatomic pathology and forensic pathology.
Did you say even though you're retired, you're still on staff at Ramsey County?
True.
So you're still doing autopsies?
True.
Can you approximate in your time how many autopsies you've done?
What I've testified to in the past, it's in excess of 6,000. Do I have any real number? No, I've lost track. It's been almost 40 years, so I've somehow lost track, but it's somewhere in that range.
Showing you Exhibit 150, Dr. McGee, do you recognize that document?
Yes, I do.
What's that?
This is a copy of the final autopsy report on Chase Fleischauer.
What was your participation in the autopsy of Chase Fleischauer?
When the autopsy was done of Mr. Fleischauer, I was a medical examiner. While I didn't examine every homicide personally, I insisted on seeing every homicide. So I would usually come in, go over the external examination to see what the results were, and then come back and do the same thing with the internal exam. So you had a clear understanding of what the pathologist was seeing, since I was signing the death certificate, or I would be signing the final report, and in some cases the death certificate. And we did that not only in this case, but on all homicides that went through the office when I was there.
In this case, did the internal exam include internally in Chase's head or skull?
Yes.
So you saw that in person in three dimensions, is that right?
Yes.
That autopsy was done on April 15th of 2018, is that correct?
Yes.
And as you indicated, you signed Exhibit 150 concurring in Dr. Mills' opinion, is that correct?
Yes.
What opinion did you concur in regarding cause of death?
Cerebral laceration due to gunshot wound to head.
What opinion did you concur in regarding manner of death?
Homicide.
To get me to my next question, what would be the difference between homicide and an accidental or suicide form of manner of death?
It requires a number of things. In this case, and in all cases of firearm deaths, you have to take the information that's coming from the death scene, wherever that takes place, what the police are telling you or the investigators are telling you what's going on, any explanation of that, plus the autopsy findings. You have to combine them all together. You cannot take anything, any finding separately. You have to combine them as a package. That's what you're supposed to do, is consider the whole gamut of findings.
And in terms of homicide, that would be a killing done by another person, is that correct?
That is the definition of homicide. This is a medical definition, a death at someone else's hand, yes.
The verdict that has been returned reads as follows. We, the jury, duly impaneled, as and for our verdict in the above-captioned matter, find Kayle Alan Fleischauer guilty of second-degree reckless homicide